I would like to give some remarks on the subject of the observation evidences and reflections, mainly present in the Polish art, but not totally. In the beginning, there were detached observations made from the distance, like those captured in the series of drawings of Władysław Strzemiński, which he began as early as in 1939. In these, he diagnosed the total war by pointing at its most devastating effect, the degradation of the human being. However, it wasn't until 1945 and his series to my friends Jews that the characters in Strzemiński's drawing, until then marked by a certain atrophy, began taking more precise shapes. This series was also the only in which the artist introduced photographic quotations from reality, which became widely popular much later. On the first books giving the personal evidence of the war oppression was the account of Severina Szmaglewska, a survivor from Auschwitz, titled Smoke Over Birkenau, first published already in 1945. The first movie was The Last Struggle, The Last Stage by Wanda Jakubowska in 1947. One of the survivors, Tadeusz Borowski, wrote the influential collection of short stories, Word of Stone, collected earlier but published in 1948, referring to human degradation of the Nazi camp. Among the many other survivors, we may list such writers as Zofia Fosmysz, Jean Améry, Imre Kertész, and Primo Levi, who wrote a significant statement. We who survived are not the real and reliable witnesses. The only holders of the awful truth are those who were drawn down, annihilated, who submerged. We are speaking on their behalf. We, the rescued, are retelling the concentration camp's experience of those who do not exist anymore. The body of literature is constantly growing, and the new generations of authors draw upon not just the accounts of the survivors, but also the confessions of the tormentors, like that of Lisa, a labor camp Auschwitzian, described by the aforementioned Zofia Posmisch in her 1962 novel, The Passenger. The encounter between Lisa, a former oppressor, and her victim was an unlikely chance to hear the arguments of the other side. At that time, such a confrontation was an unprecedented act. The novel, written by Zofia Posmisch, was adapted to a film of the same title. The Passenger was released in 1963 in unfinished form, due to the tragic death of its director, Andrzej Munk, and therefore the film was left rigid in form, similar to the documentary Night and Fog from 1955 by Alain René, the first documentary movie about the concentration and death camps. Speaking of Polish literature, one should also note the exceptional contribution of Leon Kruczkowski, whose drama The Germans from 1949 listed a whole spectrum of German attitudes toward Nazism, making the feeling of guilt and responsibility increasingly relative. Kruczkowski was also a co-writer of the script for Tonight the City Will Die, a film by Jan Rybkowski, in which he went as far as accusing the Allied forces of being responsible for the destruction of Dresden, 1961. The survivors shared their trauma in different ways. Jean Améry wrote his indictment against the Nazi system of repressions as a collection of essays at the mind's limits beyond guilt and atonement. In their subsequent books, Imre Kertész and Primo Levi excavated memories, bringing up still new details and elements of that other life. For Paul Celan, it took merely a handful of poems, which came to be widely remembered for the oxymoron Schwarze Milch der Frühe, and his pair of notions, such as Mon und Gedächtnis, which are still analyzed by subsequent generation of scholars. The Polish artist Józef Szajna, Auschwitz prisoner number 18,729, first noted the horror of death camps on tiny slips of paper, only to turn them later in his environment piece Reminiscences, which conjured up phantoms of the dead and the objects they left behind, both in the gallery as well as on the theater stage. Jonas Stern used rags the color of mud and applied animal and fish bones on the surface of his paintings. For both Szajna and Stern, it took years to arrive to the point at which they were able to translate their trauma into art. Up until that point, their practice was the affirmation of life. Szajna, a survivor from Auschwitz, and Stern, who had a narrow escape from an execution, were reluctant to speak about death for a long time. This was also the case of Alina Shapochnikov, who could consider herself lucky. As a young girl, she ended up in Theresienstadt after having passed by Bergen-Belsen and Auschwitz. These artists felt that their fate was exceptional, not because they were hurled into camps, ghettos, or prisons, and not because they faced a firing squad or stood above the grave they had to dig for themselves. It was a time when such situations could be considered the norm. What was really exceptional was the fact that they managed to stay alive. This was the very reason why they chose to turn towards the future and to develop concepts associated with the modernist paradigm, which was violently disturbed by the war. A paradigm that removed from the horizon the gloomy terror of their recent experiences. The war appeared as chaos, which brutally upturned the existing order, and not as a rigorous and therefore dead order, which took the place of the dynamism and motion as symptoms of life. Only about half a century later, Zygmunt Bauman analyzed the relationships between totalitarian system and the notion of modernity. After more or less the same time, Gerhard Richter, the German painter, grasped the real meaning of the series of his own painted painting based on the photographs from family albums, such as Tante Marianne or Familie Amère. One could say that it was relatively early when Richter reckoned with his youth fascinations in the paintings like Stukas or Onkel Rudi, and pointed at those who were guilty of violence against their own nation, like Mr. Heide. He also began collecting materials documenting the death camps, which he would include in his atlas since 1963. But these themes only found their culminating point in Richter's four oil paintings of 2015, referring to the documentary photos secretly taken by the prisoners of Auschwitz. The dangers lurking in the rigidly formatted logistics of the modern life were addressed by Miroslav Balka in the historic district of Zamość, a city in the south of, southeast of Poland, founded in the 16th century as an ideal settlement, where he introduced a replica of the wall of the kitchen building from the Auschwitz camp. This is how the utopia of Renaissance and the utopia of modernity found a common denominator in the extermination camp. Andrzej Wróblewski, an active participant of the post-war struggle for the shape of modernity, witnessed the war still as an adolescent boy and depicted it later as a phenomenon which disturbed the existing harmony. In his paintings, harmony relates to the structure of the human body, which is deprived of its form by death. In these moments of transition, the human figure can collapse into a pile of fragmented remains or evaporate in the clothes, in, from its clothes, which are left as a trace of the still living shape. The body can also become its own shadow or a blue afterimage. The notion of afterimage was used by Władysław Strzemiński to describe an image that stays under the eyelids once we close our eyes. This temporal aspect is extremely important, in particular the adverts before and after. In this case of Wróblewski, the concept referred to an essential distinction between life and death. This change, the transition from the living to the dead, is often represented with nothing else but color. This is how the artist conveyed the very important, the very moment in which the memory of I retains the image of living person, even though that person is already dead. Andrzej Wajda, a peer and friend of Andrzej Wróblewski, was marked by equally tragic experiences. In his output as a film director, the war is the main focus of 10 works, the first four of which accounts for his entire early Earth from 1955 to 1959, although the echoes of war are still to be found in later films addressing contemporary themes, notably like Everything for Sale from 1970, which features Wróblewski paintings, Wajda initial works already tell a bitter tale of Polish fate. In a generation released in 1955, the death of the main character puts an end to a sudden outburst of young resistance under German occupation. The attempt to escape from the hell of the Warsaw Uprising in Canal from 1957 is bound to fail. While in the Ashes and Diamonds from 58, a survivor from the uprising dies on the Victory Day, marking the last day of the war. The fate of the characters portrayed in these films was already sealed in September 1939, a fact that was also confirmed in the film Lotna, released in 1959. Which pictures the invasion of Poland from the point of view of a squadron of Polish mounted cavalry. Last but not least, there is Samson from 1961, a symbolic closure of this whole series of Wajda's early works. It addresses the Holocaust from the perspective of a biblical parable. Two other characters of Wajda movies die accidentally just after the end of the war. The Jewish girl Maria in the landscape after the battle, after the novel of Borowski from 1970, and alter ego of the Vajda, of Vajda himself in Katyn in 2007. This dramatic determinism, which forces the chosen ones, the survivors, to share the fate of the victims, here is a significant message about the inevitability of roles scripted by history. This fact is also attested by the books of such German-speaking authors as Thomas Bernhard, Siegfried Lenz, Günter Grass, Winifred Georg Sebald, Martin Polank, who was here yesterday, Ingeborg Bachmann, mentioned by the Chancellor, and Klaus Tevelate, among others. They all speak about the cost of the war in a language less modest than that of Paul Celan, who likewise wrote in German. Among the readers of the works by Romanian poet was the German artist Anselm Kiefer. His Mon und Gedächtnis took the form of a lead airplane, a motionless vehicle of memory, sinking into the ground under its own weight. Kiefer is neither a witness nor a participant. He belongs to that second generation which inherited the memory of the victims and the perpetrators, or perhaps inherited the guilt itself. Much like Felix Dröse, the author of the piece I Killed Anne Frank from 81, and Jochen Goetz, who summarizes in his works the crimes of the generation of his fathers. In order to address the most dramatic questions, the artistic substance had to be stripped of excessive illusion to an even greater extent than the language of literature. This was how the work of art established links with outer extra-artistic reality. Situated in the board on the border between art and non-art, the artwork became more physical, or as one could say, more tangible. Only then its form and matter could accommodate the artist's message and situate it in the realm of the universal. Alina Shapochnikov became a sculptor, first marked with the stigma of racial impurity, then, after the war, burdened with the irretrievable lack, a result of genital tuberculosis from which she suffered. Shapochnikov established a conversation about death on the context of life, because decay only becomes legible in the context of a complete whole. In order to make her message clear, the artist highlighted the biological aspect of the human existence by dismembering the figure, tearing apart the form, disintegrating the material, and disturbing the existing canon. The legs, lips, breasts, and sections of faces are all parts of a dismembered, ever incompleted body. These fragments were extracted from the whole and reduced to the role of an object fetish, which captured the artist's body in negative cast, multiplying it and letting it circulate freely. By focusing on selected elements, Shapochnikov soon discovered the sphere of lack, which invited reflection about such notions as wholeness and completeness that were removed from the perspective, like the body that once touched a wrinkled shirt, that is now merely a memory of an imprinted buttock in Requiem pour le cul. But in her body-like shapes, torsos, submerged in the formless folds of black polyurethane, one can already notice a touch of death, even though they were created before the artist was diagnosed with a terminal disease, which she later tried to tame in the series of works known as Tumors. The advert before and after, much like the blue after images of human figures in Wróblewski's paintings, convey a state of being in between life and death, which was characteristic of that time. It is a state of a chronic disease shared by all survivors and passed down onto their spiritual successors. Among these successors is Miroslav Balka. His work 37,1, presented at the Venice Biennial in 1993, speaks of a raised body temperature, which is not yet a fever. This temperature conveyed in the work's title was translated into a sculptural piece made from terrazzo, a material traditionally used in Polish tombstones. It communicates a specific notions of memory through temperature and proportion. Further works of the artist were equally ascetic in their allusions to the experience of an individual subject to oppression and pain. First and foremost, through the associations triggered by specific material, such as terrazzo, ash, soap, or salt. These were soon joined by an ambient soundtrack and moving image. Removed from their original context and contrasted together, these elements became material for an art, which refers as much to intuition as to knowledge passed down as part of war legacy. Marked with this knowledge, we see more than we are actually shown. As individuals defined by culture, we are able to find allegories in simple statements, such as the flight of a moth over the floor of a railway car in the work Tanz, or the hiss of gas burning on the kitchen stove burner in Blue Gas Eyes. The artist leads us down concrete passageways into metal cages, subjecting them to noise, exposing to a reversal stream of air, or restraining our movements. These are the moments in which we experience the works physically, participating in a ceremony which seeks to conjure up and strengthen the sense of bond with the absent others. The contagious memory of war has also spread on to other Polish artists. One of the recurring motives of the practice of Artur Zmijewski is the concept of being marked, which relates not only to the inheriting of trauma, but also to the specific patterns of behavior from the time of the war, like in the video's Game of Tag from 1999. The agent that reinforces and supports these patterns in the collective consciousness is, quite especially, the media. The media create a secondary, transform knowledge, and shape a similar attractive image of the participant of those events from the past. This concerns both victims and perpetrators, but perpetrators in particular. Those media personalities superimposed in the forgotten faces of actual criminals are so deeply rooted in the collective imagination that all gestures aim at disturbing the mechanism in which the past is being substituted for the present fiction meets with the resistance and aggression. Here is enough to recall the political and press debate over the Nazis awards of exhibition of Piotr Kleinsky in 2000, sparked off by the artist's decision to present a collection of photographs of celebrated actors taken at the time when they played the roles of Nazi officers. Equally violent was the first reaction to Zbigniew Libera's Lego Auschwitz, the work conceived as a moment on the dangers connected with making the Holocaust a common, ordinary theme, and was eventually withdrawn by the Polish curator from the exhibition at the Venice Biennial 97. Libera's piece points at the media as a key instrument in the process of turning the evil into a banality. Therefore, it would seem that the most intriguing phenomenon for contemporary artists is not the hell of the war itself, but the mechanisms in which facts are repressed and replaced by fiction, as well as the inevitable process of effacing the memory of the actual events. We can trace this approach in paintings by Belgian artist Luc Tuymans. Faded like old photographs, they capture desolate interiors of no qualities, seemingly dull and uninteresting landscapes, or people devoid of any characteristic features. In order to reach to the deeper meaning of these works, one needs to reach for the facts from the past, decode the messages which are hidden under the names of towns and villages, and refer to the knowledge of practices and preferences of the followers of the Third Reich. While in the paintings of Wilhelm Sassner, the barely visible characters and events looming in the distance or enlarged details out of scale and context act as reminders, but not of facts themselves. They allude to recent books and movies based on them, which have already become a history. The subject of repressed, blurred memories returns in the film by Anka and Wilhelm Sassner, It Looks Pretty from the Distance, from 2012, which speaks of how evil is passed on from generation to generation. Similar themes are found in works of younger Polish directors, like Aftermath by Władysław Pasikowski from 2012, Ida, the Oscar winner, by Paweł Pawlikowski from 2013. In addition, we have seen the arrival of films which present the drama of Warsaw Uprising in 1944 in new light, such as Warsaw 44 by Jan Komasa, released in 2014. In light of the above, the debate concerning the present-day consequences of German occupation is still very much alive in Poland. One of the contributing factors to this situation is the opening, ongoing scientific research which systematizes the historical materials. There is no indication of the fact that this topic will fade away anytime soon. Sorry, I had to be very brief due to the time limit, and if you have any question, I'm open in the later.
Thank you very much for this interesting lecture and presentation.